Once there was a holy place, evidence of God's embrace. I can almost see mercy's face pressed against the veil. Looking down with longing eyes, mercy must have realized that once his blood was sacrificed, freedom would prevail. As the sky grew dark and the earth began to shake, with justice no longer in the way, mercy came running like a prisoner set free. Past all my failures to the point of my need, and the sin that I carried was all I could see. When I could not reach mercy, mercy came running to me. Once there was a broken heart, way too human from the start. The years left it torn apart, hopeless and afraid. Walls I never meant to build left this prisoner unfulfilled. But freedom called me even still, it seemed so far away. I was bound by the chains from the wages of my sin. But just when I felt like giving in, mercy came running like a prisoner set free. Past all my failures to the point of my need, and the sin that I carried was all I could see. When I could not reach mercy, mercy came running to me. Sometimes I still feel so to my heart, just to remind me, mercy came a-running like a prisoner set free. Past all my failures to the point of my need, and the sin that I carried was all I could see. When I could not reach mercy, mercy came a-running to me. All my failures to the point of my need, and the sin that I carried was all I could see. When I could not reach mercy, mercy came running to me.
Amen. Wasn't that good? Aren't you grateful this morning for God's mercy? I sure am. You know, it's good to be back. Me and my wife had an opportunity to get away for about a week, and it was nice. It was hot. Arizona is not the coolest of places. And what about this weather? Amen. Man, isn't it wonderful? Makes you want to say amen again, doesn't it? Hey, yeah, it does. Oh, I'm just glad to be here. We like to take a little opportunity. If it's your first time at Elm Grove ever or in a very long time, go ahead, slip your hand up. We want to get you a bulletin this morning, just information. We got somebody right down here. Gentlemen, if you get her a bulletin, thank you so much. But also, if you did not get a bulletin yet this morning, please get one. We got a lot of things going on in the church. It's good to be aware. There's a little visitor section in that bulletin if you'd fill that out and put it in the offering plate. Just basic information, credit card, social security number, all the basics. But thank you so much. We're going to sing some more songs. Amen.
I've not always been faithful, but He has. I've not always been grateful, but He has. I've not always been true, but He's always come through. He has, yes, He has. Greatest friend this world's ever known. He has been the dead on Calvary alone. He's given me a melody and song. He has, yes, He has. I tell Him I'm not strong, He says I am. I say I can't go on, He says I can. I've not loved everyone, not always overcome, but He has, yes, He has. I can't see what lies ahead, but He has. I can't conquer death, but He has. When tempted to sin, I fail the test again, but He passed, yes, He passed. Oh, He has been the greatest friend this world has known. Seen the dead on Calvary alone. He's given me a melody and song. He has, yes, He has. He's given me a melody and song. He has, yes, He has.
We've been supporting the Love Groves 5-6 years now from Elm Grove, but I've known Josh, I was just calculating in my head, and I can count that high. It's about 25 years we've known each other. And yes, I'm older than 25, amen? but no, it's a blessing to have them. My son ran into them actually at camp, and I was down there visiting just to make sure the camp week was going all right. And the camp director, also named Josh, was talking to me. He's like, yeah, we got some people from Ethiopia here. And anytime somebody says Ethiopia, I always think of the Love Groves. And he said, yeah, it's like Josh. I was like, oh, Love Grove. And he's like, how in the world do you know Josh Love Grove? I was like, it's a small world. But I'm excited to have him come and preach for us. Brother, you come up and give your heart an open ear. Amen. And let's hear what God's laid on his heart.
So much, Pastor. Thank you. We love you guys. Well, your pastor has been a dear friend of mine again for about 25 years. That's hard to believe again that we are that old. Yes, so we are joining the XYZ Fellowship, as they called it at the church we grew up in, I think, pretty soon here. But we are blessed to serve the Lord. And I love your pastor. He's a dear friend. And if you know your pastor well, you know that he is a man who is full of joy. And I'm so thankful for your pastor and his wife, both who have been dear friends for many, many years, 2.5 decades. That sounds like a longer time when I say it that way, right? But we are so thankful for Elm Grove Baptist Church. Our family has now been on the mission field there in Ethiopia, East Africa, for over 6 years. And we got to meet your pastor, who's now with the Lord, before Pastor and Mrs. Seba, about, I think I want to say, around 7 years ago. And we appreciate your faithful prayers and support so that we can do what you saw on the video. And that is people's lives being changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. God is still changing lives in 2024. And it's our job as believers in Jesus Christ to tell someone else what God has done for us. So you hear us say hallelujah a lot in that video, because we often say that in Africa. And my dear brother Patrick knows about this, because we say hallelujah. And you know what hallelujah is in the 80 languages plus of Ethiopia? It's hallelujah, okay? So you can say, you know, all the languages of the world pretty much, because if you say amen and you say hallelujah, it's the same in almost any language of the world. And that's what we're going to be saying for the rest of eternity, because of the blood of our Savior Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and rose again. We can say hallelujah, we can say amen, and we can rejoice that we have a home in heaven with the Lord. Let me give you a little bit of an update on what God has been doing there in Ethiopia. Now, I know Brother Patrick this morning, who shares the missionary updates, has already updated you. I think he said a few weeks ago he updated you on what God is doing there in Ethiopia, and we really appreciate that. I want to say, I mean, I don't know very many churches. We have churches across America and even other countries that support our ministry there in Ethiopia, East Africa. But often, as a missionary, it can feel lonely on the mission field. And you can feel forgotten. But I had tears in my eyes as I heard Brother Patrick this morning, just heartfelt sharing about that dear missionary family there in the Koreas, doing the work of the Lord. And I'm thankful for churches that still understand and still give and still pray so that the gospel can go all over the world. So thank you for your genuine heartfelt care and love for missionaries. Because we have a commission. We have a mission to fulfill, and that is to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. In Ethiopia, we are in Africa's second largest country in population. Ethiopia now has a population of around 123 million people. Now, my parents were missionaries in Ethiopia back in the mid to late 90s and then had to leave due to some unrest there. But at that time, the country's population was less than half of what it is today. So the population has more than doubled in the last 25 years. So there is a great need for the gospel. We're one of very few independent Baptist missionaries that are in the country due to a lot of political unrest and instability. But God has kept us safe, and we have been blessed to serve the Lord there for the past about 6 years or so. About 5 years or so ago, about 5.5 years, I guess now, we planted the first ever Baptist church in our area of Ethiopia, known as Legatafo. And by faith, we moved to that area not knowing a soul. A house had been provided, basically a living room for us to meet in for our church and a few other classrooms above us. And we said, you know what, this is what God has called us to do. So we learned some of the language, the national language, and we planted that church by faith. And on that first Sunday, we saw around 40 people that came. A lot of them were friends that came kind of from far away that could not continue to come. But they came to encourage us as we planted another gospel light there in Ethiopia. And that day we saw two ladies come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. And we rejoice now in the years that we've been there in Ethiopia to see around 400 Ethiopians now come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. We had recently our fifth anniversary, I guess about 6 months or so, 6 months or so ago. No, I guess not that long ago, just back in April, I believe. Was it April? May, June, July. Yeah, so I guess just about 3 or 4 months ago. And we had 688 people in attendance on our fifth anniversary. God has blessed us now with a new 10,000 plus square foot facility. It is a rental facility, but the Lord has put us in the biggest building in our area of Ethiopia, right off the main road. And we are on the 7th floor. And the reason being is the cost is lower as you go up the floors. And it's very hard for a church like ours that is very rare in Ethiopia. There's just a handful of Bible-believing Baptist churches in the whole country. To be able to even find a place to rent is really a miracle of God. much less for God to say, hey, here's the brand new building right off the main road. I'm going to give you an incredible deal so you can rent this out and use it for my glory. And that's exactly what we're doing. We just had our Vacation Bible School, which I think you might have heard about in the last update. Well, we had 235 kids this year that attended our Vacation Bible School. 19 of those children were personally dealt with and came to know the Lord as their Savior. And just this morning, we rejoiced as we got a great report in our kids' class and nursery and what God is doing in the service there about visitors and our church members singing. And you know, it's just a joy to serve the Lord. It's what you were created for. It's what God made you for. He made you to know Him and to make Him known. And there's no greater joy in all the world than to serve Jesus Christ. So we are rejoicing in what God is doing there. And it's all by God's grace, and it's all for His glory. And we could not do it without churches like yours who faithfully pray, who faithfully give, so that we can be halfway across the world doing the work of the Lord. So we want to say thank you from our hearts for your faithfulness to pray for us, to support missions. I think your pastor told me that you have 52 missionaries. Is that correct? Around 52 missionaries? And I thought about that, and I thought, you know what? There's 52 weeks in the year. Isn't that wonderful? So you have one missionary every week that you can focus on like you did this morning. And your missionaries appreciate that. That means so much to us. So thank you for your faithful prayers and support. If you have your Bibles this morning, I hope you have a Bible. If not, I believe there's one provided for you there right in front of you in the pew. And I hope you'll grab that and turn over in the New Testament book of Colossians this morning. As we look into the Word of God, Colossians chapter 1, we'll be looking this morning at verses 24 through 29. And my message is simply entitled, We Preach Christ. We Preach Christ. You know, no matter if you're here in America or halfway almost across the world in Ethiopia, our message is one and the same. And Paul said it this way in Philippians 1:21, For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Because Paul's saying, I get to go be with Christ. I believe if the Apostle Paul was up here this morning and speaking to us, we would listen to him very intently, and we might ask him some questions if he was with us this morning. Paul, what was the purpose of your life? And I believe Paul could simply answer, Christ. Paul, what is the message of your life? What is the message you preach as you travel all over the world? And I think you guys have the most beautiful and largest map of any church of the world back there. And Paul, you're traveling through all these countries, and what are you doing? And I believe he could answer again with that same word this morning, Christ. Paul, what is your hope? What is the goal of your life? And again, the Apostle Paul would answer for us, Christ. You know, the truth is for every believer in Jesus Christ, we should be able to truthfully answer in the same way. Because our message, our lives are about one person, and that is the person of Jesus Christ. Because only Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Only Jesus is God who came down as man and died on the cross so that you could be 100% sure that you have eternal life with Jesus Christ one day when we pass from this world. What hope and joy we have in Jesus Christ. And the message we preach has not changed, and it never will. Our message is Jesus Christ, and that's what the book of Colossians is all about. Colossians chapter 1, as we come to this chapter in the Word of God, focuses in on who Jesus Christ is. And we see that Jesus Christ is to be first in our lives. Notice Colossians chapter 1, verse number 18. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. So as the chapter begins, it tells us that Jesus is the creator. He is God the Son. It tells us that Jesus is the sustainer of all things. It tells us that Jesus then is to be preeminent in our lives because he is the Savior of the world. Verses 24 through 29 give us a powerful passage as we finish up the first chapter of Colossians chapter 1. It tells us again about who Jesus is and how we can take our lives, on this earth, wherever God has placed us, and how we can preach Christ. So I want us to look this morning as we look into this passage. Let us read verse 24 through 29, and then we will pray and ask God to bless as we consider how we can preach Christ this morning with our lives. Notice with me Colossians chapter 1, starting at verse 24, reading down to verse 29. Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you, and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh, for his body's sake, which is the church, whereof I am made a minister, according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but is now made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. Let's go to Lord in prayer, ask his blessing on the preaching of his word this morning. Lord, we are so thankful for the privilege to gather together today with freedom in this country to worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We thank you for the salvation found only in Jesus Christ, that we can know for sure that you love us, that you proved that love on the cross, and you rose again, proving that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, we pray for any in this room this morning that have never made that most important decision to call out to you by faith alone, through grace alone, in Christ alone, to be saved, that this morning they would understand the good news of the gospel. And they would receive the greatest gift of all, the gift of eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we're so thankful that even though we deserve death, you came and gave your life so that we could be saved. Help us never to get over the great, so great a salvation that you have given us. Lord, we have a message this morning we need to preach. And there are many other messages the world tells us to preach. But Lord, we know from your word that you are the most important message of all. Would you help us this morning? Would you grow us? Would you change us this morning through the power of your word, through the power of your Holy Spirit? Would you convict us and help us to change where you've called us to change? And would you help us to go out of this building as believers in Jesus Christ, ready to preach Christ through every aspect of our lives? Please empower me and strengthen me this morning. Empty me of myself. Fill me with your Spirit. May you be glorified today and lifted up. And may you draw all men unto yourself. We pray these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus is to be first in every area of our lives, because Jesus is God, and Jesus has paid the ultimate price on the cross, giving his life for yours. Now, there's no greater love than a man lay down his life for his friends. And even though we were God's enemies, even though we are all born sinners by nature and then shortly after become sinners by choice, God in his great love still said, you are not my enemy, you are my friend. And I love you so much that I am willing to pay any price so that you can be saved. And let me say first of all this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, there are many here today that would love to take the Word of God, the Holy Bible, and show you how you can be sure that heaven is your home one day. God says he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And when we come to an understanding that we are sinners and that Jesus has died for our sin, and we repent of our sin and come to faith in Jesus Christ, we can be sure, based on the unchanging truth of the Word of God, that we have eternal life. That is the most important message of all. But for many of us in this room this morning, we know that message well. We've grown up, like Brother Daniel and I, like your pastor and I, we've grown up hearing the gospel. I mean, how many times have we heard the gospel? We know our lives are to be about Jesus Christ, but how many of you know there are many distractions that come, that Satan and the world and the flesh bring into our lives to tell us there's something else that's more important to preach with our lives?
some other agenda in the media and movies and entertainment and friends around us and the world around us encourages us not to preach Christ with our life, but to preach a different message. But only the message of Jesus Christ will matter for eternity. It was the missionary C.T. Studd many years ago, a missionary who spent some of his life in Africa and then also in India, that said, only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Have you forgotten that this morning, believer? A believer of Jesus Christ who says that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ? Have you forgotten that the message of your life, the most important mission of your life, is to preach Christ? I want to encourage you this morning as we look into this passage this morning about four aspects or four different ways that your life and my life can preach Christ. Notice with me, first of all, this morning, we preach Christ through our sufferings. We preach Christ through our sufferings. Paul says in verse 24 of our text, "Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you." Doesn't that sound strange? How many of you rejoice and get happy when you suffer? That's not the normal response of the human being when you suffer. The normal response we have is, you know what, to kind of complain, kind of get downhearted when we're going through suffering. But Paul says, I rejoice. Because Paul understands if you're in the will of God and God allows you to suffer, then God must have a reason for allowing that suffering. And that reason is always to bring more people to Jesus Christ. You know what the greatest message of your life is? It's when you're in the trials. It's when you're in the suffering. It's when you're in affliction and you find out what you're truly made of. And others see Jesus in you and they see, hey, I wouldn't respond that way if I went through that. And they see there's something different about us. The Apostle Paul, as he says in this letter, he's rejoicing in his suffering. He's sitting in prison for preaching the gospel. But he's still rejoicing. Because Paul is saying, you know what? My life is all about Jesus Christ. And God had completely changed his life. And no one is ever too far gone for God to reach down and to reach you. You see, Paul had gone from being the one persecuting Christians to being now the persecuted Christian. He was in a Roman jail as he wrote this book of encouragement to the church in Colossae. And Paul's saying it's a privilege, it's an honor, it's a joy to suffer for the name of Jesus Christ. Paul's saying, I get to understand more some of what my Savior went through for me. And Paul is saying, I want to know the fellowship of his sufferings, as he said in Philippians chapter 3. Don't ask God to remove the suffering from your life if you're living in the will of God. Ask God, what are you wanting to teach me through the suffering? You know, Ethiopian Christians understand about preaching Christ through their suffering. At one time in Ethiopia, there were over 40 Baptist missionaries in the country. That was back in the 1960s. And a call went out from Emperor Haile Selassie, who met with the leader of one of the largest Baptist missions organizations not too far away from here many years ago. And he met there with the leader of this missions organization in Ethiopia, and he asked, please send 100 missionaries to my country. And the call went out all across America. The emperor of Ethiopia is asking Americans to come from Baptist churches. And he says he'll give us land and he'll give us, let us start schools. And he'll give us everything we need. And over 40 surrendered to go to the mission field. And God was doing a great work there. And then the communists came in 1974. And they overthrew the emperor there. They killed the emperor of Ethiopia there, who was very well known, Emperor Haile Selassie. And all of the missionaries had to flee the country. During that time, all of those Baptist churches that had been started by those American missionaries were taken over by the communists. And there's stories that we've read and heard about some of the pastors I knew as a boy who went through that horrible time. And you know what I noticed when I was a boy? When I first went to Ethiopia, I was 13 years old. I was the same age as my oldest son, Jeremiah, sitting back there with my wife, Ruth, and my other two boys are back in the kids' class having a good time, Joel and Jonan. But I remember this. This is what always stuck out to me after I came back to America, after my parents had to leave the country due to some other unrest. Those Ethiopian Christians who had been through that time of persecution, where their churches were surrounded by military officials that had turned communist by the Russian-backed regime there at that time, and their churches were turned into communist propaganda centers, and the pastors were taken and tortured and thrown into prison and separated from their families, what would you think? We would think they would be miserable, bitter at all the suffering they had endured. But you know what I found? The Ethiopian Christians I met, they were the most joyful Christians I had ever met. Suffering brings you through something where you realize the goodness of God and you realize and feel the presence of God and you know that God is with you and you find out God's grace is sufficient for all of your suffering. Amen. And your life preaches Christ probably the loudest when you're going through suffering, when you respond right to that suffering. Would you ask the Lord to help you to respond with joy with his power when you go through suffering? We preach Christ through our suffering, but notice with me, secondly, this morning, we preach Christ through our service. We preach Christ through our service. Paul says in verse 25, whereof I am made a minister. Now that word sounds pretty fancy, doesn't it? The word minister, sometimes we hear that, oh yes, minister so-and-so, reverend so-and-so. And you know, it's a title of respect for someone who's serving the Lord. But you know what? Minister is a fancy word for servant. That's all that it means. Paul is saying, God has called me to be his servant. And the servant is never about himself. He's about pleasing his master. He's about making his master look good. And that is our job as Christians, is to make Jesus look good. And when we preach Christ through our service, through giving our lives to be a testimony for Christ at our workplace, in our community, when we're at Walmart with the other half of the church, right, Pastor? Okay, Pastor said he went to Walmart, I think, yesterday, and he saw at least five members of the church there in Walmart, you know? I guess it's like a second church gathering, you know, you just go over to Walmart and you'll see everyone over there stocking up on groceries, okay? But you know, wherever you go, not just in the church house, but whatever house, whatever place you go to, we're to preach Christ through our service. We're to be about serving God. And how do we do that? By serving others. Read the life of Jesus. Read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You know what Jesus was doing? He was constantly serving others. He was helping the unwanted, the castaways, the sick, the blind, the lame, the unlovable. The ones society says are unwanted or not good enough or the castaways. He was caring for the poor. He was caring for the harlot. He was caring for the tax collector. How well are we doing, church? How well are we doing as believers and disciples of Jesus Christ in showing the love of Jesus Christ by serving, as Jesus put it, the least of these? Jesus said, inasmuch as ye have done it unto the least of these, my brethren, you have done it unto me. When you serve someone who is less fortunate, or maybe they can't physically give anything back to you, you are never more like Jesus than in that moment. That's what Jesus came. He came and sacrificially laid down his life as the Lamb of God to show us, to give us an example to follow. You know, I've often thought of John chapter 13, where Jesus, before he's going to go to the cross, gets down and takes on the job of the lowest servant. And he tucks in that towel and takes off his outer garments and he takes the job of the lowest servant. Now, if you've been to East Africa, like our dear brother Patrick here, my dear friend here, Kenya's right next to Ethiopia, then you understand that those who have money or influence within Africa, you have people that serve you. It's very normal for people to have someone who washes their dishes or washes their clothes or takes care of their kids or does other things like that. And you know who gets the job, the worst job? This is going back thousands of years. Eastern culture. You know who gets the lowest job? Hey, you get to clean the bathroom.
You get to clean up when someone gets sick. The lowest servant, the youngest servant, the newest servant. Hey, that's your job. I'm past that. But Jesus said, no, as a servant of God, there's nothing that I'm too big for. And if we ever lose the humility to scrub a toilet for Jesus or to clean up something when someone gets sick, then I believe that's the moment God will stop using us. Because Jesus said, you know what? I'm going to leave you an example. And Jesus got down and he washed all of the disciples' feet that day in John chapter 13. All. And when he washed the disciples' feet, there were 12 pairs of feet that he washed, including the feet of Judas Iscariot. You ever think about that? Jesus is down washing the feet of the man who a few minutes later will take those same feet and will go out and betray him. But Jesus was saying, you know what? Love your enemies. How do you love your enemies? How do you love those that don't love you, that don't stand where you stand? You know what you do? You love them to Jesus by serving them. We preach Christ through our service. You know, a few months ago, we had our 5th anniversary and God blessed in a great way on that day. And we saw hundreds of people coming and we had prepared for that day and prayed for that day. And we were so excited about what God did that day as more people came to know Christ and hear the gospel on that day. But one particular lady wanted to come that day. But if you understand where we live, we were in a nice building and there were elevators there. But that doesn't mean they're working. We have 2 elevators in our building, but they've never been used. And every time you come to church, you have to go up those stairs. And you know what? We've never had one Ethiopian ever complain about going up 7 flights of stairs to come to church. So you have to go up about 135 steps to get to our church. Well, on that 5th anniversary day, we had actually tried to get the elevators to work that day for the first time so that if we had someone who couldn't walk well or had a handicap, was in a wheelchair, that they'd be able to use the elevator. But it didn't work out for us to use it that day. Well, one of our men came running up to me before service and he said, Pastor, there's a lady here, but she's in a wheelchair. She wants to come to church. What should we do? Bring her up. Yeah. And sure enough, 4 men that day, you saw in our video, her being brought up the stairs around the final turn of 14 turns, because there's 2 on each flight of stairs. Going up all those flights of stairs, carrying 1 on each side so this lady could come. And she was right in front of me as I preached that morning, right in the front aisle, right on the side. And she was so happy to be there. She felt so bad that those men had to bring her up, but she said, I want to come to church. And those 4 men said, we're going to pay any cost. We're going to serve in any way so that others can hear the message of Jesus Christ. What message, what cost are you willing to pay in your service so that others can hear about Christ? We preach Christ through our service. But notice with me, thirdly this morning in our passage, we preach Christ through our words. We preach Christ through our words. Paul says the mystery of the gospel that's been given to us is Christ in you. It's the hope of glory. Verse 28, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom that we might present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Paul says we have a message to preach. We have to show others the love of Christ. We have to have a good testimony that goes before us through our service, maybe through our suffering. But then at some point, you've got to open your mouth and tell them the reason for why you're different. And the reason why we're different is because of what Jesus has done in our lives. Not that we're better than anyone else. Not that we're any different than anyone else. Simply that we've been saved by the grace and mercy of a loving God shown to us in his Son, Jesus Christ. Because we know who Jesus is, we have an opportunity and a responsibility to share that message with other people. God has called us to tell others the gospel. I love those 2 words we see 3 times in verse 28. These 2 words, every man. You know, our job is not done in the world until every man, every person has heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, you can't ever bring the message to the wrong address. You ever get a package, you know, from Amazon or some other place and they deliver it to the wrong address and you're kind of going, I wonder what's inside this package, you know, but it was actually your neighbor's next door. or the neighbor across the street, and you got the wrong package. It was sent to the wrong address. The good news is when you bring the gospel to someone, there's no wrong address you can go to. Because every man needs to be warned that because of our sin, we deserve death and separation from God. But because God loves us, there's a way of escape through Jesus Christ to have eternal life. And we have a responsibility to warn every man. And then after we warn every man and they come to Christ, we then have a responsibility to teach every man. So that every man, when they stand before God one day, can be presented in spiritual maturity before Jesus Christ because they have done the will of God for their lives. We have one family you saw in the video, and you saw them on their wedding day. Just over a year ago, we had a double wedding at our church. Two of our families that I'd brought through premarital counseling, both who were living in sin before, living with each other outside of the bounds of marriage that God has designed, both of them chose that year to make the courageous decision to honor God. And they both went through premarital counseling, and they both were married, and we had a wonderful day that day. Well, one of those couples was Balachu, was the husband, and the wife's name is Ababech. Balachu and Ababech both come from a very sad background, a very abusive background, dealing with a lot of alcohol. And both of them have been saved, and now they've been baptized, and they're being discipled and growing in the Lord. And now God's blessed them with two children. Well, at the time they were married, they had Tizita, who was already a teenager, and she is our most on-fire teenager for the Lord. She wants to know what she believes, why she believes it, how she can live it out and share it with others. And she's constantly asking questions. She's teaching in our nursery. This morning we had 15 kids at our church in our 0 to 3 year old nursery. And she's going to teach in a few weeks to our kids class. And she's being trained up to serve the Lord with her life. She was led to the Lord by my wife. And she's been baptized in our church. She's been discipled. Now she's serving the Lord with her life. A few weeks ago, we had our vacation Bible school, and God blessed us with a new record this year, 235 kids. And one of those kids that this last week that heard the gospel and was saved was their younger son, Biniam. Now, Biniam's one of our boys' best friends, and they love to play with him and a number of other boys. They play what we call football. You know, that's the real name for it, right? It's not called soccer. It's called football. Amen. So they play football outside in the front foyer kind of area of our church before service, and they love to play with their friends there. But Biniam understood the gospel just a few weeks ago, and Biniam was saved. And the Sunday before we left to come back to America, just a few short weeks ago, Biniam was baptized. Now God has blessed them with a new baby boy named Emmanuel. And we pray that one day he'll come to know Christ as his Savior. Ababech, the wife, also brought her sister a few months ago. And Ababech's sister was Orthodox from the Coptic Church, somewhat similar to Catholicism. There's a lot about religion. There's a lot about Jesus, but they do not know Jesus personally as their Savior. They do not understand that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we rejoice a few months ago that Ababech's sister Emusha was sat down with. Now, Emusha's from a tribe in the countryside, and she does not speak the national language. So we had to translate through three languages to share the gospel with her. And my wife sat down and then translated from English into Amharic, the national language. And then Miss Roman, the lady that helps us there in the ministry, she translated to Ababech, who's saved, into the national language. And then Ababech took what she heard and translated in her tribal tongue to her sister, who's now not just her physical sister, but is now her sister in Christ, because she has come to know Christ, and I had the privilege of baptizing her recently. What am I saying? Well, because somebody took the time to preach Christ through their words, an entire family, and we pray many more generations have been impacted. Who's going to be impacted for the gospel because you opened your mouth and told someone else about Jesus Christ? We preach Christ through our words. We preach Christ through our words. And notice with me, lastly, this morning we'll be done. We preach Christ through our work. Paul said in the last verse, whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. Do you see a lot of words about work in that verse? Labor, working, worketh. What is Paul saying? It's a lot of work if you're going to serve Jesus.
It's not always easy. Sometimes it's stressful. Sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes it's discouraging when others reject you or they rip up a gospel tract or they persecute you. But you know what? It's always worth it for Jesus. Jesus was worthy, was willing to go to the cross for us. We should be willing to endure and serve faithfully the one who has saved us and has completed the work so that we could be saved. You know, the mission field and serving God anywhere requires very hard work, but God's grace is sufficient. Jesus is worthy. I love what 1 Corinthians 15, verse 57 and 58 tells us. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Would you ask God to help you to continue to work hard for the only work that will matter for eternity? To preach Christ with your life? Can I ask you as we close this morning, how loudly is your life preaching Christ to others? Do you serve others so your life can preach Christ? Do you faithfully preach Christ with your words? And how faithful are you to share the gospel with others? Are you being faithful to run the race that God has set before you? Would you ask the Lord today to help you to faithfully preach Christ through your suffering, through your service, through your words, and through your work, so that a lost world of almost 8 billion people today can come to know and follow Jesus as well, and the other Christians around you can be encouraged to make their lives count for Jesus Christ. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for your word this morning. We thank you for Elm Grove Baptist Church. We thank you for Pastor Daniel Ward and his family and for each and every member and visitor that's here today. Please work as only you can during this time. We give you all the praise and glory. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.